Good evening, Captain. Welcome to a guide about engines, your tool to dictate the dynamic of a fight and force the enemy to dance to your tune. Denying him the chance to retaliate, not letting him catch a breath while you drown him in shots, outflank him to target weak spots, or just having the option to retreat and save your men. Engines can do all that and more for you, and I will show you how to make good use of these fuel-to-noise converters. We will discuss the following topics. First, we will discuss different engines that are at our disposal and how to pick the right ones for the job. Then we talk some numbers and limitations concerning speed, especially top speed, discuss outside versus inside engines, the generic engine room, and some tricks concerning movement. Let's start off with the small thrusters, which come in three varieties. These things are often overlooked due to the fact that their propulsion is garbage and they also have the worst thrust-to-weight ratio of all engines. What makes them unique, however, is their ramp-up time. Do you sometimes feel like your ship behaves heavy even though you plastered it in giant engines and very little armor? Ramp-up time is to blame for that, which a small thruster has none of. Why is that desirable? Because it means that on smaller craft you can make quick turns or try to dodge as the ship starts to react to your command almost immediately. Add in the advantage that they are small and consume the least amount of battery charge and have the longest lifespan at 100% thrust, these things certainly have their uses in the early game. If you use their small size to put them on the ends of your ship where they can use some leverage, you can make a nimble fighter early on. Bonus points for the fact that you can have multiple directions of thrust while only needing the space and crew attention for one. But let's not oversell that thing. The moment your craft starts to resemble a frigate, you will probably trade it in for the next category, the standard thruster. 3 times as much thrust as his little brother. Even better that it is only 2 times as large and slightly lighter than 2 small thrusters, resulting in a higher thrust to weight ratio and space efficiency. The trade-off? Ramp up time and a bigger dead zone. Manageable, but something that you need to keep in mind if you want a small ship with a boxed-in engine room. Large thrusters. Once you start using them, you will probably never get rid of them. Best thruster you can ask for without diving into exotic materials, and with 2 seconds ramp up time, this 3200 kN beauty will be your companion even into the late game, as it provides enough thrust in a reasonable time frame to be useful on crafts that rely on maneuverability and quick adjustments. Just to reiterate, even the most high-end ships still have large thrusters at key locations. Ships like the Odysseus or Voluntas, for example, which are already past the 3 million mark. Again, more space efficient if you consider kilonewton per tile, but it has the same battery uptime if fully charged. Huge thrusters, surely living up to their name. 8 megatons of thrust in 9 tiles, and thus the highest thrust per space invested and best thrust to weight ratio during normal operations. So why don't we exclusively use this engine? Because A, it's a huge jump in price and the first on the list that requires a rare resource, tri-steel, and B, it has a 4 seconds ramp up time. Quick course corrections or dodging is getting needlessly difficult with these things. They are perfect for accelerating in one direction or do wonders for your maximum speed, but if your ship needs to rotate or flank, you should stick to large thrusters if your size allows it, or use the large ones at key locations as maneuvering thrusters. A ship that only relies on huge thrusters can certainly be fast, don't get me wrong, but it's also going to be incredibly sluggish as every command takes 4 seconds before you have the desired thrust available. But if you are hellbent on using them for everything, you can certainly do so. That, however, requires manual control of your craft and a decent amount of piloting skill, as you would need to predict enemy salvos. It's also viable for ships that only ever go in one direction. Kiters or Deccan rammers come to mind. But sometimes it's not enough to have decent speed. Sometimes an enemy is just a few meters outside of our reach, or is almost in a firing position that would bypass our defense. That desperately needed short boost is exactly what the boost thruster provides. Under normal circumstances, it is basically a large thruster, but a bit larger and more expensive. Plus, it has an absolutely ridiculous dead zone. But you won't care, because for about 8 to 9 seconds, that thing will outperform even a huge thruster by providing 9.6 megatons of thrust with 0 ramp up time. Placed at the correct locations, they can start to rotate even the heaviest flagship and can get you out of the stickiest situation. I can't even count how many times these things allowed me to catch a missile boat or escape an unfavorable fight. You can't resupply it while boosting, however, meaning that placing a large reactor nearby with 30 crew won't increase the boosting time. Lastly, not a thruster, but an incredibly useful tool, the engine room. This room increases the power output, but also the consumption of every adjacent engine by 50%, and also acts as a central access point to the engine's power storage, meaning that your crew members can drop off their battery in the engine room, and it gets supplied to the engine that needs it, therefore costing you more energy and two additional crew members as they need to operate the engine room, but overall a massive gain to your thrust and crew efficiency. The engine room's ability to act as a supply point for engines doesn't override the booster's special condition during its boost, however. Even with an adjacent engine room, it runs out. Also, it means that your boosters will run dry even quicker, as the 50% increase in consumption also includes the continuous power drain and not just the thrust itself. This block is one you can't skip. No matter if you look at AI or competitive ships, all have them. The buff and crew efficiency it provides is way too good to pass up. The only reason why you wouldn't use them is because your ship is too small or you haven't bought the blueprints yet. I won't let any other excuse count. But let's talk numbers. How fast can we go? Don't worry, these lines will make sense in a second. While you accelerate, you have drag that increases with your velocity, meaning that you can only accelerate as long as your forward thrust is bigger than the drag. Fortunately, Captain Redstone tossed me a bone once again by providing the actual formula for drag, which helps us to visualize our problem. The relevant numbers that you need are your weight, thrust, and resulting acceleration or thrust-to-weight ratio, more or less the same in this context. With that acceleration, we go into our graph and see where it collides with an imaginary speed limit. As we can see, it lines up quite nicely. You can also scale this up to whatever tonnage you want. As long as the thrust to weight ratio remains 120 for example, you will always have the top speed of around 117 meters per second. Keep in mind that boosters will temporarily increase your thrust, thus also increasing your top speed. However, you won't keep that speed after the boost and instead you start to slow down until you reach equilibrium again. 120 meters per second is also going to be your magic number, by the way. Previously, you were able to accelerate for a longer time and gain speeds that are above your acceleration. However, at roughly 120 meters per second, that is no longer the case. Instead, you will reach your top speed faster, yes, but adding more thrust will give you diminishing returns for your top speed as the drag escalates. The problem is that your acceleration is linear if we ignore ramp up for a while. You can see this with the orange line. At about 120 meters per second, the drag starts to outscale our thrust. Therefore, we also need exponentially more thrust to keep up. I won't discourage you to get a small boat with a nuke launcher that has a thrust to weight ratio of 460. In fact, I actively want to see them in action. But unless you have a very specific task in mind, you should really think whether this is a good use of your space and resources. But enough numbers, let's get to the building part. Two options from the get-go, boxed in versus outside. Boxed in is theoretically the superior option as you can protect your engines and stay maneuverable, even while being attacked from all sides. Also renders you borderline immune to EMP strikes against your engines. So why does the open design even exist? Because boxed in can be really space hungry. You basically have to build your ship and armor around massive dead zones later on and have to protect them too. Open, however, places the engines on the outside of your ship and allows you to trade security for more space efficiency, as you only need to protect the engine itself. Make good use of structure and spaced armor, and even an open engine can be well protected, maybe even a shield besides the engine room. And I'm just gonna claim this. Diagonal is better for open engines, simply because it allows you to have thrust in all four directions while protecting your engines both on the front and the rear, meaning your foe in front of you can't shoot straight into your exhaust, and chasers have the same problem. Open also has an easier time to put engines on ends of your ship where they can use leverage to turn your ship faster. As a rule of thumb, agile ships should take open and brawling ships should take the box. Next up, you always want to have as many engines connected to an engine room as possible. Makes your thrust per tile better and always takes stress off your crew. A reactor nearby that is connected to your engine room via walkways and you are good to go. This would be your standard setup engine room with huge thrusters all around. But we can change a few things based on preference. We might exchange a few huge thrusters for large and standard thrusters to have thrust available quicker. Might make more sense if these clusters are based a bit further away from your center of mass, as the leverage takes care of the lost thrust, therefore making you able to turn quicker. Same thing goes for boosters. Put them further on the inside if they should be better protected, or further out if you need to make a quick 180 degree turn. The whole how to build engine rooms is pretty straightforward. Keep your thrust to weight ratio in mind, use leverage to your advantage, and remember your power consumption after the engine room buff. Also, if you only have engines at your rear, you will make a burnout like a car in order to turn. If you want to turn on the spot, you need engines scattered around your center of mass. Spinners would be a good example. Also important info for strafers and orbiters, as leverage can also work against you. If your center of thrust is not aligned with your center of mass, your ship will try to correct during your orbit around an enemy ship, meaning that engines closer to your center of mass will put out less thrust, while thrusters further away from your center will fire in the opposite direction to counter the over-rotation that is caused by you trying to fly sideways. So ideally, you want to have engines equally distributed across your rear and sides. Doesn't need to be a wall of engines, but if you have two sideways thrusters at the end of your ship, you should also have two at the front. So let's get into some nice to know things. If you have never used explosive charges, I wouldn't blame you. They can be useful, however, if you need to get rid of armor in order to gain some speed. If the enemy kites you, you can throw away side and rear armor, thus only keeping your front. If you need to kite yourself or need to escape, throwing away side armor might be a good idea. It's something that you will rarely use, but having the option in tight situations is always useful. Especially if an Iron Man mode gets implemented at some point and you rather lose some parts instead of the entire ship. Tractor beams, probably the funniest way to punish poor engine placement or overly exposed ones. If your beam overpowers the rotational force of the enemy's ship, you can rotate it to your heart's content, and it's unbelievably satisfying to rotate ion beams or railguns. Nothing that I would call game breaking, as you actually have to shoot a few thrusters before your tractor beams are able to overpower the enemy's thrusters, but it's a very handy tool if you want to annoy some people. Or you double down on tractor beams and make them a core part of your strategy. 6 beams in a 1.5 million range should suffice. Just be aware that this thing takes 4 crew members, 4.5 energy per second and 25 tiles. That's a lot of space and resources, so actively use them if you go down this path. Last one has a bit of numbers in it again, so I keep it quick. If you build diagonally, use the parallelogram of forces. 2 times 100% force in 2 directions in a 90 degree angle will cause the resulting force to be 141%, so you might need more engines for raw top speed. But that's all I have for you right now. I hope that covers the most essential parts, and feel free to share your tips and tricks in the comments section. Next week my vacation is over, so depending on the workload my upload speed might decrease, but thankfully we got the huge topics out of the way already. Thanks for watching, and I will see you next time with a guide about logistics and printing money. Captain Caffeine signing off.